Good morning.
Morning.
Boy, it's so good to be able to worship together today, and we welcome you into our worship services. For those that are joining us online, we welcome you as we worship our Lord together today. We're blessed this morning to have a great worship time as well. And here in our sanctuary, I don't know if Lindsay is able to get that picture up or not, but here in our sanctuary this morning, we welcomed our brother Brad Daugherty back from serving overseas. And so we praise God for that. Thankful that Brad was able to get back and to worship with us today. We're thankful for him. Thankful for his service. And so we're glad to celebrate Brad being home. We do have several that we want to remember and several of our prayer requests. And as we're sharing our prayer requests, for those that are online, I encourage you just to say hello to one another. And that way you have a time of fellowship as well. But we want to continue to pray for Alex and Shade and Grady Kate. Just excited for them and welcoming Grady Kate home. And continue to lift up Brother Harold and Miss Pam Bryant. Amanda Hughes, we've got on our prayer list as she continues to heal. Karen Parkinson and her family, we lift up Karen. Greg Patterson, after he has recuperated from his kidney surgery. Brother Dillard Moore, we continue to pray for Brother Dillard. He'll go back for another treatment this week. But Brother Dillard has had a pretty good day today, is what he told me this morning when I got a chance to see him. So we praise God for the good days. And continue to pray for him as he continues his treatment. And remembering Willard Moore as he recuperates from his thyroid surgery. Jeff and Tanya Langley. Jeff is continuing to battle with his hip and his back. Miss Audrey Reeves, we lift up Miss Audrey in prayer as Miss Audrey is recuperating from her procedure. We lift up Amy Tillman. This is Gary and Kathy Newby's niece as she continues her chemotherapy. Be in prayer for Taylor Browning and be lifting her up in prayer as she continues to go for testing and different things for her health. Pray for Rhonda Nickel. Miss Rhonda is continuing to battle the effects of the chemo that she's had. And there's our picture up there for Brad and Amanda. We're so thankful that he came in last night, and we're very blessed to be able to welcome him home. Of course, also, be in prayer for Miss Reba Nickel. Miss Reba's been under the weather, so pray for her. Ellison Beard asked me to remember her Aunt Sally and her Uncle Edwin in prayer, and so we pray for them. Michelle and Bruce Denmark, both of them have COVID. Bruce is in the hospital right now, so be in prayer for Bruce as he continues to recuperate from that. Walter Waddell, who has been diagnosed with throat cancer, we pray for Walter. Also the family of Charlie Laxton. Mr. Laxton passed away this week, so be lifting up Cheryl and her family in prayer. Pray for Miss Betty Nairmore. Miss Betty has COVID, and she's asked that we as a church family pray that Johnny doesn't get it, and so be lifting them up. Also, Kenneth Clayton, this is Kathy Newby's brother. He has some health issues, so as a church family, be lifting up Kenneth in prayer. The Burgess and Easter families, be in prayer for both of them. And also the Kenneth Lingerfelt family, this is Jeremy's dad, be praying for them. And I also appreciate remembering my brother Greg as he continues his chemo. And also my Aunt Faye was taken to the hospital with some heart issues. So I appreciate you remembering my Aunt Faye in prayer as well. As I look across our sanctuary, I can't help but know that you've got somebody on your heart this morning. If you've got somebody on your heart, just raise your hand. We've got many all over our sanctuary. As we go to the Lord in prayer today, I ask that you join me. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you, God, for this day and your blessings and love. Lord, I just ask for your hand upon each one that we mentioned today. God, you know the names and you know the needs. And Lord, the many that were unspoken, the ones that are on our heart, and the many, Lord, that are dealing with so many different issues, we lift them up and ask, Father, that you may move in each circumstance. God, we pray for our church family. God, we've got so many that are battling this virus. So many that are battling the effects of it. God, I pray that you just may, Lord, bring healing and that you may touch each one. We give you thanks for what you've done in our church. Lord, what you're doing and Father, what you have in store for us. We just ask that you may continue to lead, guide, and direct us in our life. Lord, help us in all things that we might give you glory and honor. And Father, I pray that as you lead us today, that you lead us to a point of decision in our lives, that we may make those decisions for you, and God, that we may make a difference in the world where we live, bringing others to Christ. Lead us now, we pray, as we worship. God, I pray for the music. I pray, Lord, that you may bless Brother Travis as he leads, and Father, for the preaching to follow, that everything is done to bring you praise and glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen.
Wherever you're at standing this morning, if we worship the Lord, we're going to start out by singing Standing on the Promises.
through eternal ages, let his praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God.
Said something that he in turn did not make good on. And so you can always stand on his promises and in his word. We're going to sing the Lily of the Valley next.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Was lost.
was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed.
I've got a confession to make. When I was a kid, I was scared of the dark. Anybody here ever scared of the dark when you were little? Just me. Okay. No, thank you for being honest. He's yawning. Never mind. Okay. I was scared of the dark. I remember when I was a kid, of course, I'm the youngest of five, and so I had two older brothers, and I have two older sisters. Jan and Jill had their room, and I didn't think it was fair, because there was never alone, right? I mean, so, but I was alone. My brother Doug was 12 years older than me, and Greg was 9 years older than me, and so they'd be out working, and I'd have to go to bed by myself, and, you know, in that one room where, you know, the thing would crawl out of the closet and get me. I knew that, right? And so there I was, and I'm in that room all by myself, and it occurred to me, I didn't have to stay in the dark. And the reason I didn't have to stay in the dark, because we had a light for our closet. And I'd go and I'd turn that light on in the closet, go to bed, and I was happy, because there was a light in the room. And that worked until my dad came down the hall and would see that light on under the door, and come in there and made me turn the light off. And then I was back. Something was going to get me. I was scared of the dark. And that's the way a lot of folks are, if they're really true. There's some things in the dark that they're scared of. And so today we're going to be looking at the dark and what God says about the dark and how God moves in the dark. So the Bible tells us in Genesis chapter 1, we're looking at verses 3 through 5, and out of reverence for God's word, if you're able, I invite you to join me in standing. Genesis chapter 1, verses 3 through 5, God's word says this, "And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. Join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, God, thank you, Lord, for your word. Lord, how it applies to our hearts and how it applies to our lives today. God, we live in a lost and dying world, a world that's in darkness. And Father, today I pray that you just may speak to our hearts and speak to our lives. Draw us near to you today, and God, that you just may, Lord, in our hearts and lives, show us, Lord, that we should be the light for a world that needs Jesus. Lead us now to a point of decision. Father, if there's anyone here today that's never invited Jesus into their heart to be their Savior, it's my prayer that today they come to a saving knowledge of Christ before it's eternally too late. God, that you may encourage in them, Lord, to come into the light. And Father, for those of us that are Christians, that Lord, that we, Lord, look in our hearts and our lives. Father, that today that we look and see if we've allowed any darkness to creep back into our lives, Father, instead of living a life that's full of your light. Lead us now to a point of decision in our lives, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. When I was a minister of youth, at a church in northeast Louisiana. We had a building there that was a building that housed our fellowship hall, and it had some Sunday school rooms for our senior adults. And so we had a youth event there that night, and the way the building was, we had a young adult building which was built almost to the edge of that building, so they were right next to one another, and there was not any light that would get through those windows. Once they built that new building beside it, it obscured all the light. And then down that, it was built with a fellowship hall on one side, and then a hallway that ran in between those two aisles of Sunday school rooms. So it had Sunday school rooms on one side, Sunday school rooms on the other side, and you had a hallway in between. Now, there was no light that would get in to that hallway. And so we had a big youth event there, and I was turning out the lights, and I realized that somebody had left the light on in the back bathroom. And so I go all the way to the back, and I turn out the light, and I'm coming up that hallway. And while one of the deacons drove by, he saw, we had a group of deacons that would go by the buildings and make sure all the lights were off, and he was on that committee. And so he stopped by, got out of his vehicle, opened the door, flipped the switch, and got back and closed the door and got in his truck and left. And I'm in the middle of this hallway, and there's no lights whatsoever. It is the aisle, I've told Crystal, this is the darkest place on the face of the earth. Because you could hold your hand up in front of your face and not see it. Because there was no light that got in there at all. I'm in the middle of the hallway. It's just as far to try to turn around and go back as it is to just keep going forward. So I'm thinking, okay, I know how many Sunday school rooms there are, but the hallway's wide enough where I can't touch both sides at the same time. You know what I mean? It's a big wide hallway between those two. And so I'm thinking, well, if I'm this far up, I'll just make my way up the hallway. And I'm trying to feel my way through the hallway. That's what happens. And so I'm touching a little bit on this wall, and I realize, okay, now I'm too far this way. I got to go back to the middle. And I found where I was when I hit the doorpost, the door frame right here. I hit it right in the middle of my forehead. But I remember how dark that was in that hallway, with no light at all. Now, the Bible tells us, here in this passage of Scripture, and if you look before, that the earth was void and form, there was no form, there was no light, it was covered in darkness, the Spirit of God was hovering above on the earth. And so the Bible tells us about there being complete darkness here. And the Bible says in verse 3 that God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. Now, What a great thought, and first a great thought for every one of us, is that God commands light. God commands light. Now I've got to share with you, I've been in church all my life, and I don't know that I ever heard my pastor preach on God's light. But I think as a Christian, it's something that we've missed out on so many times, to understand where God says, "Let there be light," and there was light, how the Bible says it, to the point where our God has command over light. And the Bible goes on to say that he separated the light from the darkness, which tells us also that not only is God in control of the light, but our God is in control over the darkness too. But there's nothing that will happen in this world that our God does not have control over. Brothers and sisters, we live in a dark world that seems to be getting darker all the time. You hear all the reports of all the things that go on in the world, the things that happen and the awful things that go on. And listen, we don't even have to go very far to know that there's awful things that happen even right around our community here. We know that there's a dark world that we live in. How great is it to know that we serve the God of light? That when our God commands light, light will come because God spoke it. Boy, brothers and sisters, that gets me kind of excited. I don't know about y'all, but it does. Because that means that my God knows every situation that I'm in, and He can bring light in every dark situation that can happen in our lives. That our God has control. That's good stuff. And that's good news for me and for you. That there's nothing that we will come up against that our God doesn't have control over. What a blessing. What a blessing that is for me and for you. And I love the way the Bible tells us here. This is the first record of creation. God's light. This is it. The very first record of creation is God's light. Where God says, let there be light. And there was light. It was such an importance that God made this the first record here in Genesis for me and for you to see. Because it's got to be important in our lives too, where we realize God's command over life. Now, and when I was a kid, I would read the Bible and I knew this, and I would, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. You know, the Bible says that. In John chapter 1, I would memorize different passages of Scripture, and I remember about light, about different things. But I didn't realize when I was a child that when God said, let there be light, and there was light, and God separated the light from the darkness, the Bible says. He called the light day and the darkness night. When God did that, it was 3 days before He created the sun and the moon. That God created the sun and moon 3 days after He'd already declared there was going to be light. What excitement is that for me and for you in our life? To know that God has no bounds for what He can do in us. The only one that will keep God from doing things in our life is me and you. We are the ones that set the bounds of where we're going to allow God to work. And God wants for our lives to be lives full of light. The Scripture says He saw the light and He said it was good and He set it aside from the darkness. God commands light. The second part, I hit just a minute ago. The Bible says in John chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, this is how Scripture says it. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the same was in the beginning with God. And all things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Not only do we see here in God's Word where God commands light, but the second thing that we can see is Christ commands light. It's getting better all the time, isn't it? Y'all don't look like you're having much fun today. You still don't. I don't know why. Yeah. Look at somebody beside you and say, I'm glad you're here today. Now wake up. Tell them, now wake up. Yeah. What a great thing that you and I can know that God commands light and Christ commands light. He commands the light in our life. The Bible here says that He was the light of men. He is the light. The light that's in Christ Jesus is the light of men. Now, that light is completely misunderstood by the darkness. The lost do not understand why we do as Christians what we do. They don't have any idea. They can't comprehend why we serve God the way we serve God. I had a guy one time ask me. He said, I've got a question to ask you. And I said, okay, go ahead. He said, do you really give the church 10% of your money? And I said, yeah, I tithe. And you know what he said? I don't see how you do that. Well, I don't see how you don't. That's the way I was raised, the way I was taught. You serve God. Serve God with your time. It's not just money. Listen, there's a lot of folks who think that serving God is about giving you money. That's the worst thing. I think the last thing. The best thing to do is give God your life. Here I am, and I'm back in that hallway. Listen, brothers and sisters, I'm trying to figure out where I am. I'm groping around in the darkness here. And there's a lot of folks in our world that are in the same position, but they're doing it in their life every single day. They're groping around in darkness, even though they have their eyes open, but they are spiritually darkened. They've never come to know the light. The life of men is how the Bible says it here. That in Him is the light of men. And you know why they don't see it? You know why they don't understand it? Because so many Christians don't live it. There's so many of us that call ourselves Christians and never live a life that's full of light. I know folks, and I think I said this a few weeks ago, that they're not happy unless they're miserable. That's true. This past week, I love to talk to folks. I can't help it. That's just the way the Lord made me. And this past week, I made a phone call. I had a product that was ruined, and I was calling to get a replacement product. That's what I was trying to do. See how much it cost to get it replaced. And so I make the phone call, and a little lady on the other end of the line, she answers the phone, and she says, "Mr. Adams, how are you today?" You know, they're making small talk. They really don't care how I am most of the time, I don't think. Yeah, folks ask you that, you know, when you go to the checkout line, "How are you today?" They really don't want you to tell them how you are, do they? You know, they don't want to hear about it. I can't help it. Sometimes the Lord just lets me do it, though. And so I told her, I said, "You know what? I am blessed and highly favored. I really am. Lord's good to me, and I really can't fuss about a whole lot." And you know what the little lady on the other end of the phone told me? She said, "Mr. Adams, thank you for saying that." She said, "Because he's awful good to me, too." And you know, I had the opportunity at our little revival right there. But she was like, "I can't really say a whole lot to everybody because, you know, I'm not able to say that to a lot of folks. But I can tell that you believe." And I said, "Yes, ma'am, I do." You know, the Bible tells us that we're called to be the light. But we're called in that light to love other people. Now, they're going to think that because we love them that there's some kind of an ulterior motive that we have. Because that's the way the world operates. If I do something for you, you owe me at that point. And I'm going to call in that favor sometime. You're going to have to, you owe me, and we're going to, I mean, it's going to be whether you're going to settle up with me or not. That's the way the world works. They cannot understand how we as Christians are supposed to be loving them. And the only way that you and I can truly love the lost and dying in this world is if we have Jesus Christ in our heart and in our life. Because Jesus loved me when I was a sinner. Jesus loved me even now that I still am a sinner. Jesus loves me despite all my warts and all the problems I got. Jesus still loves me. And there's nothing that will separate me from His love. You know, I do the best that I can do, but there's sometimes I sin and I fall short of the glory of God. And you know what I do? I continue to prove the Bible true every single day, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Every one of us. We've all sinned. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Oh, that you and I, you come to that saving knowledge of Christ, the light shine in our life, and then we come to Him. Oh, the Bible here says that the darkness is completely, they can't understand the light. See, we're called in that light to love others, and that's a love that truly makes a difference. And I like to say it this way, we're called to love others to Jesus. But they see in us the whole reason why we love them. It's a love that we have because God loves them. And God wants a relationship with them. We truly want to see our our area changed, we want to see our state changed, our nation changed, we want to see the world changed, then we as Christians need to start loving unto Jesus. You see, God commands the light. Christ commands the light. And Christ calls us to be the light. I love how the Bible says in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus is speaking here, Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 through 16, and he says these words, "Ye are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." Why in the world do we ever try to disguise the light that's in us? Why do we ever want to keep that light from shining out in everything we do? Why is that? Just like that little lady, I want to share it. That would be a most miserable job for me that I talked to. It would be a most miserable job because if the company that I work for would tell me I can't tell others that Jesus loves them when I'm talking to them on the phone, boy, how awful would that be? Somebody's calling in with a problem to be able to help them not only with the problem they have here, but also an eternal problem they may have. You know, we limit ourselves to what we're going to do for the Lord. And we attempt to, it seems, to hide His goodness. When I was a little kid, one of the holidays that I really liked was we'd always get together on the 4th of July. I liked the 4th of July. Because we were good Baptists and we ate. Right? That was one of the big things we did. We had a big cookout, we'd eat, and then we would go out when it got dark, and we had fireworks. Now, we had fireworks. I don't know, I'm not talking like poop. I'm talking about boom and all the little things that go off. Pop, 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 pop. And you know, it was just one of those great things. The Roman candles, we had them. We had the big ones that shoot way up there. It was great. And I remember as a little kid, I just loved the fireworks, seeing all the things going off. But I also remember that as a little kid, when I was really little, my mom and dad or somebody would come and give me one of them little sparklers. You know what I'm talking about? And you light the end of it, and you're going like this. That's what you get to do. I got a sparkler. I didn't want a sparkler. I wanted a Roman candle. I wanted to do, 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 do. Ooh, ooh, that's what I wanted. You know? And I got the sparkler. You know, there's only figure eights that you, you can't do a whole lot with that, right? And then it burns out and then it's gone and, you know, oh, here's another one. Woohoo. Okay? Right? That's all I had. Why do we want to settle for something that's a sparkle when God calls us to be light? In our own lives, why do we want to just sparkle? We ought to want the boom in our lives. Amen? It ought to be something that's on display that folks see and they say, there's something different about that person. I wonder why they have such an attitude of light. I wonder why they have such an attitude of joy. Because we know Jesus Christ, and that's what separates the light from the darkness. And that's what it is. As the light is separated from the darkness, as God said that He separates the light from the darkness, it's the same in our life. Jesus is the light. He's what separates the light from the darkness. To know Jesus is to know light. To not have Jesus is to be in the dark. Oh, church, that you and I would do our best to be the light for God. Christ calls us to shine. And I love how He says it here. He says, let your light so shine. He tells us the degree that our light ought to be shining. It ought to be shining in everything we do. It ought to so shine out of our life. Let your light so shine. Oh, listen, we can make a difference. We can make a difference by somebody looking in our hearts and looking in our lives and seeing what's different about us because of who Jesus is. Oh, He loves us. And He has such He has such a plan for our life. Oh, friends, you and I can look around and see that God loves us. He loved us so much that He gave Jesus to die on the cross. He gave the light to die, to separate the light from the darkness, so that you and I can have a relationship with Him. That we would accept Christ, and that we would live for Him. Maybe you're here today and you've never invited Him into your heart and your life. I want to encourage you, today's the day. Oh, He calls you today to come, to experience a new life, a better life, a life that's full of light and life. You know, to be the light as we travel through this life, and to be light. You know, that word light has a couple of different definitions. Jesus uses the other definition when He tells in Matthew chapter 11, "Come to me, all ye that are labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." That's how He says it. Let me ask you today, how much burden are you carrying? How much burden do you carry? Every one of us, if we were honest today, would say we have a burden. Every one of us would. That's the truth. Because we know the burdens, Jesus says, "My burden is light." How much does light weigh? He wants to free you from your burden today. Wherever you are in life, no matter what's going on, He knows. He wants to separate that darkness from you. He wants to separate the weight. He wants to separate the sin. He wants to separate the shame. He wants your burden to be light. He wants that happy, joyful spirit in your life. And today He bids you to come. To be light. For the very first time, someone here today may say, "I need Jesus as my Savior to come." Here in just a few moments, we'll have a hymn of invitation. I invite you to step forward. Maybe someone today just needs to come go down to the altar and pray. Maybe you've got a burden. And you say, "Lord, I need my burden to be light. I'm going to bring it to you today." We have an open altar. As the Lord calls and as He leads you, bring it to Him. Maybe today you may say, "I've allowed some darkness to creep into my heart and my life that shouldn't be there. And today I'm calling on the one who commands light to come into my heart and to help me through the circumstances that I have." Maybe that's you today. Maybe you've got a friend or somebody you love that you know is going through a hard time, but you just want to come and kneel down at the altar and pray for them. As He calls and as He leads in your life today, you come to Him. You respond. Pray with me. Lord God, I thank You, Lord. Thank You, God, for the light. The light that You bring into our hearts and in our lives. Father, today as we bow in Your presence, we know that You're here. And as You call us to a point of decision in our life today, Father, maybe someone to step out from where they are and say, "I need Jesus as my Savior." Maybe someone today that would honestly say, "I've been carrying a burden, and today I want to bring it to Christ." Lord, I pray that today that we would be honest before You. Lord, maybe you've placed a burden on our heart for someone else today that we should come and kneel down at the altar and pray for. Lord, I pray that whatever decision You've got in our hearts and lives to make, that we would make it before it's eternally too late. Lord, move in us, I pray. And God, may we be faithful to respond. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to send Him.